these are my disclosures. As introduction, we can say that urethral stricture recurrence is a common and known concern, and as we have seen, dilation of the urethra and internal ureterotomy has similar results on long term after 12 months, and the worst results we can see them after 3 procedures. So how can any drug could help in avoid this urethral stricture recurrence? We designed a prospective, non-randomized, open-label, multicenter study under a common protocol in Latin America with target of male subjects with single urethral stricture less than 2 centimeters, less than 12 French diameter of the urethra, with 1 to 3 prior diagnosis of internal urethrotomy or any other procedure, no prior urethroplasty, and significant symptoms. The objective were evaluate the safety and effectiveness by evaluating the stricture recurrence, the improvement of symptoms, the serious complications related, and the changes in erectile function, Qmax, sperm quality, and the pharmacokinetics of the drug paclitaxel in blood, urine, and semen. The balloon used was a 24 and 34 French balloon, 3 centimeters in long, with active drop paclitaxel. Under cystoscopy and fluoroscopy guide, we did a predilation, and then we applied the DCB and held in pressure for at least 5 minutes and left a Foley catheter, 14 French, for a maximum of 5 days. We did follow-ups at days 5, 14, 30, 90, 180, and 365. As anatomical success, we defined it an urethral lumen greater than 14 French, and treatment failure as IPSS score of greater than 11, the needed for retreatment or exit the study early because of IPSS greater than 11. The median age were 50 years, etiology were traumatic or iatrogenic mostly, and the prior endoscopic procedure 1.7. We saw an improvement on Qmax of from 5 to 19 milliliters per second, the reduction on PVR from 141 to 26 milliliters, and 12 months follow-up, the stricture-free rate were 74%. No treatment-related serious complication, no significant impact on sexual function, and the paclitaxel concentration immediately was just above the titulation limits and below the detectable limits in other time points. So we can say that urethral dilation with paclitaxel drug-coated balloon is effective and safe at 12 months follow-up with no observed impact on sexual or reproductive function.
So this presentation is open for discussion now. I have a first question. How can you say that this is an effective treatment while you do not have a randomization with placebo, drug-coated balloon, or no drug-coated balloon?
We can say that it's effective for these patients. We don't have any comparison group or control group.
Mm-hmm. Also, do you think that the number of patients that you treated in this study would reach sufficient power to come to any conclusions?
We treated 53 patients. It's a procedure that has not been done before. It's a phase 1 trial. So these are initial results. Maybe we need a longer or series to say that we have a big group of patients.
Yeah. Shouldn't be then a better conclusion that it is a feasible procedure, mm-hmm, rather than an effective procedure?
It's reasonable. Yeah. Yes, thank you.
Paul, you have another question?
Well, no, I agree that or that this is a promising procedure, mm-hmm, but what comparative trial would you do? Because I think if you wish to get this published, you would have to describe this as an exploratory study. So what randomized controlled trial would you do in order to show its efficacy against standard care? What would you regard as the standard of care here?
Standard of care would be the DVIU, the direct vision internal ureterotomy. That should be the procedure of control groups to compare.
And do you have plans to do that?
Maybe in the future.
Maybe.
Any Good. Other questions from the floor? If not, we thank you. There is? Okay, yeah, Peter. Yeah.
There is something funny. You present underpowered, so you must be continuing this study on the ethical review board. You should have done a power calculation, a sample size. You should be aware of which sample size you need to arrive at a certain conclusion. So is that true or not?
I didn't understand the question.
It's impossible to start a study on the ethical board review without a sample size calculation. And you state, you give the answer, and you say, yes, this is underpowered, and we do need to do more research. And before jumping onto randomized studies, you should finish this study under adequate power.
Yes,
it's impossible to stop it, but I do not know what your ethical board says, but this is Helsinki regulation that I'm citing now.
We are expecting to follow up these patients to a 5 years period.
Mm-hmm. But if this is a new technique, then you have no information on which to do a power calculation.
Even for feasibility, you should have an endpoint which is feasibility, as you suggested. Maybe it's a feasibility.
Yeah, but then feasibility.
And then you should have a feasibility.
Yeah, sorry,
endpoint.
But feasibility then doesn't go with a power calculation. That's another determination. Then it's a number to indicate the safety primarily, and eventually the feasibility of the study.
And from a point of principle, when you do a study like this, which is an exploratory study, you should study as few patients as possible.
Yep.
Because it's exploratory, you don't know what the adverse events might be.
Everything that you say should be convincing to the ethical board and should be underlined with numbers.
Okay, since we're not the ethical board here today, I think the message is clear that I agree with your statement that this type of research should be scrutinized, and this is a worldwide obligation. I think that's the main message. Thank you for your presentation.
Thank
you. The floor to my co-chairman for the next.